Is done? Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
Today, we are going to cover up this interesting chapter, which is common childhood illness. Okay? This is very important as a preschool teacher, as a mother, okay, as a friend to some of your friends' children. You need to know some of the common illnesses which affects this early childhood. Okay? As you all know, early childhood is the age, what they say is early childhood, the early 5 years of age, and later when the person goes to the old age, they both are to be considered as they are traveling in the same boat. Why do they say that?
They are dependent in both the stages.
They fall sick very often.
Maybe the memory span.
Kids' memory span is very good.
Yeah.
That's because of the aging process, so the memory goes down. Okay? Then, these two are the most vulnerable groups because of many reasons. One thing is, in the early 5 years, most of the organ systems are not that very well developed. Okay? Because it's still in the growing stage. Okay, the maturity, what we call, it happens only after the 5 years of age. And many of the organs, it takes its own time. Some takes 11 years, like the bone. For the entire bone to grow, it takes around 12 to 15 years. And there is a lot of variation in that. Okay, so the organ systems, usually all your lungs, liver and the heart, it's very well developed. Heart doesn't grow later. Okay, the lungs especially. It's very much prone to infections in the early age. Okay? So we'll discuss that in the chapter, why is it prone. So before that, why this early 5 years of age they have problems is compromisation in the immunity. Okay? Their capability or their strength to fight against infections is very less. Why is it very less? Why is it very less? Because immunity is less, resistance is less. Why is it less? Because
they are coming from like the different new world, so they need to develop that thing.
Okay, so immunity is basically, what happens is, what is immunity basically? Just the basic term. I'll not go very deep into the medical aspect. Just the basic term. What do you mean by immunity? Just take the mic, otherwise you'll not be audible. What is immunity? No idea?
Resistance to the external whatever factors. Also.
Whatever factors. Okay. Then, anybody else? Can just help her out.
The resistant to fight against certain bacteria.
To fight against certain bacteria. Yes, very good. Then just pass it on to her.
Immunity is called power of stamina.
Power of
stamina.
Histamine. Histamine is something which is related to allergy.
Allergy.
Okay. If your histamine level is more, you'll be more allergic.
Allergic.
Okay. That's not. Yeah. As she said. Or as she said, is the power to fight against some infections. And this is not that very well developed in a child. Okay? That's why any of the pediatrician, if you take your child, they say you wait for 5 years. For anything you say, you just wait for 5 years. If he is having often cold and cough or this thing, fever and all those things, you wait for 5 years and then we'll see what best we can do. Yeah? Why that 5 years is? Because the child's bodily system, it takes that long year to develop a good immunity power. Immunity, how it comes is, like, for example, the child has affected with an infection. Maybe a viral, maybe a bacterial. Okay? So once he has got that infection, what happens? In the body, you have some cells which is called as anything which comes out from the body, like maybe the bacteria or the virus which is entering into the body is called as an antigen. Okay? It's called as an antigen or some foreign substance when you call it the layman term. Okay. So what happens? Anything foreign, we usually don't accept it very easily, right? Do you accept anything which is causing harm to you? If any person is causing harm to you, you don't accept that person, right? What do? You try to reject that person. You try to fight against it. The same thing the body does. It tries to fight against that infection, against that antigen, basically. Okay? So the body starts forming something called as antibodies. What is it? Antibodies. To some extent, the white blood cells. White blood cells produces these antibodies, which has the power to fight against those antigens. So that is called as the antigen-antibody reaction. What is it called? Antigen-antibody reaction. During this process, when this fighting and this struggling and all is going on, the child will show symptoms like fever. Fever is something, but it's not a disease basically. Okay? It's basically a symptom. What the child is showing because of some problem. What problem? Usually fever is it's a manifestation of an infection in the body. We don't know where it is, but it's somewhere in the body there is some problem. So that shows as fever. Why in the child, even a small amount of bacteria, even a very mild bacteria also causes problem is because of this. The white blood cells are not that very well developed. It does not have the power to produce more antibodies. So that's how, if the body fails to fight, if the fever is persisting, then we take external antibiotics. Antibiotics is also, it does the same job, like how the antibodies does. So you have different various antibiotics available for different conditions, right? Okay? So that's why in children, because of the immunity, they are more prone to infections. In this chapter, we're going to study the different areas how a child usually manifests. Maybe the immunity, what will be the eye problems, what will be the ear problems, what will be the gastrointestinal problems, what will be the respiratory problems, what is the ENT problems, which commonly you need to know as a preschool teacher, because you need to identify at least some of the minor problems. Clear? That is what we are going to learn in this chapter. Yeah, this I have told almost. So I'll just read it out again. Before children reach school age, they must negotiate threats from a number of diseases, and more than 50% of the child deaths are caused by pneumonia, diarrhea, malaria, measles, malnutrition and HIV. We'll discuss about this later. Okay? So what they say, around nearly 50% of the deaths are because of all these conditions. Pneumonia, diarrhea, malaria, measles, malnutrition and HIV. Yeah? But now, because of the a better medical facility, a better technology, these death rates have also come down. Earlier, the death rates were more. Yeah? Because they didn't have that good medications, that good facilities. Yeah, children in the age group of 0 to 14 years are the important age group in all societies, and since they constitute about 40% of the total population, and these are the most vulnerable groups. Why, if they have taken us 0 to 14 years, is this is the school age they have taken. Okay, 0 to 5 is the early age where they are more prone to infections and some diseases. Then later what happens, they are more prone to accidents, children, and the disease incidence comes down a bit. Once the organs and once his capability to fight against infections are well developed, these chances comes down a bit, but they are more prone to accidents. Okay? Yeah. Like while playing or while going out, okay, sports injuries, they are more prone to that. And this again depends on their age, sex, place of living, socio-economic class and other variables. We are not going to discuss in deep about this. Okay? Now for our reference, what we usually do is, we divide the childhood into these age groups. Okay? The childhood has been divided into infancy. Infancy matlab, it's up to 1 year of age. This is the age where they are most common. Most commonly they get infected. Most commonly they have lots of diseases. That's why they say you have to take proper care of a child. Okay, so in this also they have divided into two. One is called as the neonatal period. This is the first 28 days of life, as soon as the baby is born. Then the second is the post neonatal period. It starts from the 28th day till the 1 year of life. Okay, then 1 to 5 years, then school age 6 to 14 years. That's called as the school age. Okay, so what happens if the child is affected with all these illness? So usually what happens, it hampers the growth and development of a child. Obviously we've already discussed this about the growth and development, what are all the factors which affects that. So once the child on and off, he keeps getting problems, if he keeps on getting affected with the infections, his growth and development is going to definitely going to get a, it's going to reduce. He will not be at par or to the level what has to be expected for that age group. Okay, then so this growth and development does not only include the physical aspect but also the intellectual, emotional and social aspects. In all the areas there will be a compromise. Fine. Here there is one small chart. What they say, this is a normal growth and development of a child. What they consider, I have just taken for the 5th year, that's it. So here what they say, what should be the weight increments and what should be the height increments. So weight increments, always usually the Indian babies, they are somewhere between 2.2 also is considered as a normal birth weight. Yeah, 2 also is considered as a normal birth weight nowadays, because most of the kids are underweight who's born to an elderly mother, like it's 30 plus or 35 plus. It depends again if she's on some medications, it's because of an artificial way, if she has conceived, babies will be heavy. Okay, and if the mother has been a diabetic in the pregnancy, baby will be heavy. Yeah, but usually they consider 2.2 till 3.5 as a normal birth weight. So now after the baby is born, 0 to 3 months, what should be the expected weight increase? It should be around 200 grams. The baby should put on at least 200 grams of weight by the end of 3 months. This may be more depending, or this may be, it should not be very much lesser than this. If the baby is not putting on proper weight, then you need to check whether the baby is being breastfed, or whether the baby is having a bottle feeding, or whether the baby has some other problem. So why the weight is not increasing? Okay, so by 4 to 6 months should be around 150 grams. On an average, 150 grams of weight should the baby have been put on. Okay, by 7 to 9 months it should be 100 grams. So what they say is, you have to check the birth weight of the baby. If the birth weight is say somewhere around 2.5, by the end of 1 year it should be at least 3 times the birth weight. That's the usual criteria what they take. So if it is 3 times the birth weight, then that means it's a normal weight gain. You have to check both weight gain and height gain to get a normal growth and development chart, because you don't have any other parameters to check here in the early age. So if you take the child to a pediatrician, they'll have a growth chart in their health card. You notice that? They check, they put that marks, they put the points, what is the weight and what is the height. Every time whenever you take the child to the pediatric checkup, they always do that. You've noticed it, right? Yeah. Okay. So by 1 to 2 years, it should be around 2.5 kg. Every year, after it should be 3 kgs more, 3 times more in the first year. Then after that, between 1 to 2 years, he should have put on at least 2.5 kg additional. Got it? Yeah? Then 3 to 5 years, an additional 2 kgs. So this is how you can calculate and say whether the child is underweight or overweight. whether he is undernourished or overnourished, yeah, malnutrited or not malnutrited, yeah. Then length increments. By the end of first year, it should be at least 25 centimeter. What was his height? What was the height of the baby during the birth? Usually check the length of the baby also. So by the end of 1 year, at least 25 centimeter growth should be there. Yeah. Then by the end of 2 years, 12 centimeter. Third year, 9 centimeter. Fourth year, 7 centimeter. Fifth year, 6 centimeter. This should be the height increments. Got it? Earlier age, it will be more weight gain also and even head gain also. As the age goes on, it slows down. Yeah, clear with this? Yeah, this is very important. You need to know this basic thing because this is going to tell why the child is not performing well in the class. What you have to do is you have to get their health card. You have to ask the parents to get the health card and check the growth and development chart there. Okay, now we will discuss the specific child health problems. What are all these? Before that, so children below 1 to 4 years of age are the most vulnerable group for many health disorders. I have discussed about this. This usually happens if the mother, there are so many reasons because of this, for this, okay. If the mother, she had lots of infections during her pregnancy, if she had some problems during her pregnancy, yeah, in the early trimester of pregnancy, if there was a fever or something, so the child growth will be stunted. It can, there can be some problem with the child, it can be an abnormal child also. I have discussed this earlier also, if you remember. Yeah. Otherwise, if the mother was infected very often during the pregnancy, after the first trimester also, if she was repeatedly, she had fever and some other sorts of problems, the birth weight will be less. So if the birth weight is less, the baby's growth will be less and the baby is more prone to infections. So if the birth weight is way less, it's obvious that the baby's organs will not be that very well developed. As it is, even a normal child, the organs are not that very well developed. It's not matured enough. Okay? It will be totally developed, but it's not matured enough. But if it's a low birth weight, definitely they are going to be more vulnerable. Got it? And they have mentioned some of the infections here, such as rubella, syphilis and HIV. So this is usually common mostly in the Western communities. Here, yeah, nowadays it's become little bit common. Okay, this rubella, syphilis and HIV. Rubella, it's a viral infection. This is not seen more now. Okay, rubella virus. And there is no treatment for this. Then syphilis, this is also a sexually transmitted disease. So here also what happens, the baby gets affected. HIV, yeah. So now what has come is, if you know that the mother is an HIV positive, that's why in the initial investigations they always get this test done, HIV, HBsAg and VDRL. So HIV is to find out whether the mother is affected with HIV, HBsAg to check whether there is any hepatitis B surface antigen. That means whether the mother is having some liver problem, if the hepatitis B infection is there. Otherwise they give a vaccine. Yeah, because it can get transmitted to the baby. All these are transmittable diseases. It can get transmitted to the baby. Yeah. Then syphilis. Yeah, syphilis of course also gets transmitted to the baby. Then HIV. What they do is, if they know that the mother is HIV positive, they vaccinate the mother. So once vaccinate the mother, they creates a barrier, so it will not cross the placenta. Yeah, it, the placental level, it's blocked, so HIV will not be affecting the baby. So that's why it's very very compulsory to check. Fine, must have seen the advertisements also. Have you seen? Yeah. Okay. So what happens is, usually in the early childhood, if you know all these problems, there are many conditions which can be treated. Yeah? And if you know the problem in the initial phase itself, you will know the consequences of that and you can always work hard to at least reduce those consequences. Fine? Now, we are going to discuss some of the, we'll start with the eye. We will discuss some of the common eye problems which usually affects the early childhood. So, how many of you have eye problems? Did you have it in your early childhood? Nowadays, if you go to any Netralaya or any eye hospital, you find all small children in the eye hospital. Yeah? That's because of the misuse of the technology, which has to be used properly. It's not been used properly, and children, they are totally occupied with the tab and with the iPad or with the iPhone or the smartphone, and they all have this specs. And eye problems is one such thing. Once it happens, it's irreversible damage. It cannot be reverted back. Many a times, it can only be corrected. So be very, very careful when with your kids. You fix a time. It's not like you don't give them at all. You fix a time. This is your time limit. You have to play only within this time limit. The entire day, the child should not be encouraged to be just with the time. Yeah? It's become very, very common now. Yeah, now we want to discuss some of the common eye problems. This is the first one what we are going to discuss, which is called as the amblyopia. This is the medical term, amblyopia. The layman term is called as lazy eye. So what do you mean by lazy eye? Very lazy. He doesn't want to work hard. Yeah? If he can't do the job, he'll better forget it. He'll not do it, but he'll not attempt to do the job. In the same way, the eyes become lazy here. One eye. What happens in this condition is, as you are seeing in that, can you just see this? It's not that very visible, right? Yeah. It's usually seen if there is any misalignment in the eye. Misalignment matlab? Once you see what happens, if it's a normal eye, where if I move my finger here, my both pupil would be moving in the same direction, right? So if I move my finger, I'll be following it to the right. Both my eyes will be following it to the right. Yeah? Some cases what happens when I'm moving like this, my one eye would be following this and the other eye would be looking somewhere else. It's not in line. Got the point? It's not in line. It's not very obvious when you look at the person. When you do this test, it becomes obvious. Because one eye, there may be because of some muscle weakness, maybe because of some other problem, what happens? The child is following, the eye does not follow the target. What happens eventually is, the brain also keeps on receiving the same signal. You all know, right? When in the eye, whatever image is formed in the retina, it's reverse. Then again, it is getting corrected in the brain. You know this, right? The basic? Yeah? It's getting corrected in the brain. And the vision of the right goes to the left and the left goes to the right. Your brain, because the eye is become lazy, it's not following the target. Because this muscle is weak. What happens? It starts avoiding this image. It starts avoiding whatever image it is catching from the, in case if you have a problem in the right eye. It starts avoiding to catch this image from the right eye. Got the point? Later what happens, this does not happen in a day or two. It takes a long time. So later what happens? The image, whatever is capturing from the right eye, it's totally forgotten. It's only catching the image of the left eye. Eventually what happens, the child, whenever he sees it as a blurred image. It becomes blur. It becomes very unclear image. Got it? This is called as amblyopia or lazy eye. Later, if this is not corrected again, what happens? This eye is totally going to forget about that image. So this eye becomes totally inactive. It's totally an irreversible damage. The damage has already happened. No matter whatever you do, this eye will not get back its normal visual acuity. Got my point? Yeah? And sometimes the child have a blur image, or he can see a double image also. Because what is happening? There is a superimposition of this image. You see, it is here and here. So this and the brain, I'll just read it out. It's not very clear, I think. So brain rejects the blurred image. So there's a blurred image which is formed. There is a house and there is a tree, right? So that image has been rejected, and there is a confusion which results from the superimposition of two dissimilar objects. The child's retina gets confused. Which object should I take? Because this is not a normal vision which is going. Gets confused, and what happens? It will start having a misalignment in the eye. That's called as a squint. Yeah. Then he's going to visualize it as two different objects. One tree and one house. Even though it's a single image, he is going to determine it as two. And then it becomes double vision. Yeah. So this is called as amblyopia. Eventually, if this is not corrected, brain will totally stop receiving any input from this affected eye. This has to be corrected. How it can be corrected? You have to know the cause of this. So if it's a squint, you have to correct that squint. Squint matlab, you know na? Yeah, crossed eye. If there is any muscle weakness, again that has to be corrected. Muscle weakness can be corrected through some corrective surgeries also, and if it is very mild, through some exercises which will be taught by an ophthalmologist. But if the child is complaining of any blurred image, usually if the child with amblyopia, what he does is he just tries to close his eyes whenever he wants to see an image, whenever he wants to write. Okay, what he does is whichever the eye is affected, he closes that eye so that he can see one single image. Got the point? Yeah. So that means you have to think it could be a lazy eye or an amblyopia. So these terms, why I have put it in a bracket, is in the examination sometimes they ask as amblyopia. So you need to know what it is. Yeah. This is the second, strabismus, or it is the crossed eye or squint. You see this very often in people. Yeah. So this, what they say is, usually in a girl child they say, and even a male child they say, it's very lucky. That's a superstition what they follow, that it's lucky. So they don't get it corrected. If you're not getting it corrected, later it's going to turn into an amblyopia. It's going to become a lazy eye, and one eye, wherever there is a squint, that eye's image is totally forgotten by the brain. Brain doesn't know what is the right eye, whichever eye which is affected. Yeah, got it? Okay. So this squint or strabismus, it's called as a crossed eye. As you can see, his right eye is normal, but his left is abnormal. Why this happens? This is because of misalignment, okay, or it's because of the muscle weakness. So how's your eye sitting anatomically in your how is it sitting in this space? You have seen your skull, right? You've seen the picture of a skull, or if you have hold the skull anytime, you have held it anytime, no? So how's the skull? You just have two holes here, big holes. You don't have any bones here. But how is this eye sitting here? It's only because of the muscles and the ligaments. It's only because of the muscles, ligaments and the soft tissues and the tendons. So for your proper alignment of eye, all these soft structures, soft tissue structures should be normal. If there is, and your eye is actually controlled by 8 muscles. Yeah, you have 8 muscles. You have muscles all around your eye. You have muscles for an upward vision. You have muscles which control the downward vision. You have muscles which control the sideward and this diagonal vision. Yeah, totally you have 8. So, if there is weakness in any one of these 8 muscles, it causes a problem. So, here the way how they are shown, so there will be a weakness with the muscle over here. That means which pulls the eye towards the lateral side. Because since this is weak, what's happening is this muscle which is strong, it is pulling it towards the nose or towards the midline of the body. This is called as the medial rectus and this is called as the lateral rectus. We are not going to go deep of the muscle name and all. So, we are just going to tell this lateral muscle is weak. That's why what's happening is this muscle is pulling the eyeball towards it. Yeah? When you are doing a corrective surgery, what they do is they give an additional soft tissue to this lateral muscle. So that it pulls it back to its normal alignment. Got it? Because it's medial, there is no problem. Because this is not working, it is pulling it. Got it? Yeah, as I told you, it is caused by a lack of coordination between the eye, and the eyes usually look in different directions. You never know where the person is looking. You always get confused which eye to follow. Okay, where is he seeing? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah. So, any person if he is having this problem and if it has been detected in the early age, and early age correction of a squint is very easy. It can be corrected very easily. Yeah. So in the adult age it's little difficult. So if we early age if the squint is corrected, the results are very good. So please, in case if you have any child in your class, if he is having a slight squint also, you tell their parents to get it corrected. If it's a very mild squint, it can be corrected by exercises itself. Yeah, exercise to the eyeball muscles. Otherwise, they have to go for a minor corrective surgery. It has to be corrected. Please don't leave it that it's a good sign. Got it? You can correct it even in the adult age. But what happens, the results might vary. Early age, always the results are very good. So, next, refractive errors. These are only the few common problems which I have taken, which usually seen in the early childhood. Okay, very common there. So next is the refractive error. What do you mean by this refractive error? As you are seeing here, this is the eyeball, right? This is how your eye looks when you are looking it from the side. So this is the cornea. What is this?
Cornea.
The black or the blue or green or whatever color you have. Okay, so that's the cornea. The white part is called as the conjunctiva. Okay, so this cornea, the image usually passes through this cornea. Your white part does not take up any image. Image is only transmitted through this black portion. In that, if you see, if you want to see the muscles of this cornea, what you do is just switch on light, stand in front of a mirror, okay? Just go very close to the mirror, just keep on observing your eyeball, keep on observing your cornea. Just go very close to the mirror, you can see the contraction and relaxation of the muscles in that. You'll have hair like structures, small miniature hair like structures. That's also corneal muscles. Yeah? Okay. So, usually normal condition, what should happen is, if you see that, I'll just draw it over here, the same. If this is the cornea, the image has traveled. If this is the image, this part is called as the retina. This is called as retina. And this is the image. Usually the image in the retina becomes inverted. What happens? Inverted. Here, then the pathway changes. There is a crossed pathway here. Crossed in the sense, from the right eye, it's going to get crossed to the left, and from the left, it's going to cross to the right. Okay? This is a normal vision. What happens usually, the image, whatever is there, it has to fall on the retina. For a normal vision, it has to fall on the retina. Yeah? That's a normal vision, and it will be an inverted image over here. But in this myopia or short-sightedness, what happens? Short-sightedness, how many of you have? Many of you will be having it. I can see a lot of specs people here who all are wearing. You all have short-sightedness, is it? Yeah? So what happens? In short-sightedness, the image has stopped here itself. It falls just in front of the retina. It does not have the capacity to travel till the retina and fall it on over the retina. Yeah? That's because you have been watching lots of TV in your early age. So that's why you have got this problem. This is what happens because you are overstraining your eye. Because of overstraining of eye, usually happens. And this is a refractive error. Okay? And here, what happens? Usually the objects become blurry. You can't see them. Yeah? So what is the problem you usually have? You can't see objects. If you make a person who is having short-sightedness to sit on the back bench, they can't see which is written on the board. There will be a blurred vision. Because the image, it was not able to travel. The eye was not able to catch up the image which was there, because the image is falling just in front of the retina. So what they usually do is, they give the corrective spectacles. What they give? Concave or convex lens. In that shape. Okay. So what they give? They give a concave lens. You know concave and convex, right? What is this? Concave. What is this? Convex lens. So what they do is, they give a concave lens here. The lens will be like this. This what happens? This will give that extra additional power to the image to travel till the retina. This depends on your power, what they check, the eye power. Yeah? You have this eye test, you have that big eye boards. They ask you to read. They have in different fonts, different sizes. Yeah? That's the way they check what's your eye power. Okay? Yeah. So this is myopia or short-sightedness. Got it? The same way, what happens? You have something called as hyperopia. Hyperopia or hypermetropia is one and the same. That is long-sightedness. Here, what has happened? The image has traveled an extra mile just beyond the retina. Earlier it was, the image was falling in front of the retina. Normal vision is, image should fall on the retina, but here it has traveled beyond retina. So this is usually seen in the aging process. Very, very common in aging process. So it's usually seen in elderly people. And for this, we give a corrective glass of a convex lens. That's why if you see in elderly people specs, it will be thick like this. Yeah? That is convex lens. And this will correct the image and it just makes to fall on the retina. And usually if there is an hyperopia or hypermetropia, they will not be able to see the one which is nearer to them. They can't see. First usual thing is, they will not be able to read the newspaper properly. It becomes blurred because font is also small. Near vision becomes blurred. Yeah? Okay. So these are the two most common ones. There is one more which is called as the presbyopia or the aging in the lens. This is nothing but what they call as cataract. Yeah. So this is because of the aging again. Here, what happens? The cornea. Can you see that image there? In the cornea, everything is normal. The image also might be falling over here. Might be just going a little beyond the retina. But here, the main problem is you have a small, very thin layer of an extra layer, which blocks the proper image to pass on through the retina. So what they do, a corrective surgery, they remove that cataract. Seen that, right? What do they call? Recently in Amritsar, a lot of people lost their vision. Read in the news, you saw the news? Read in the newspaper? Yeah. So if it's not done properly, usually nothing happens. If you are not taking a proper aseptic precautions, because of the infection, many people lost their lives, lost their eyesight. Yeah. So here what happens? As they have shown, that lady is struggling to read that. It's almost similar to hyperopia only. But here, there is an additional one layer in the cornea, just behind the cornea. So once you correct that, it will become normal. Got it? So these are the common eye problems which you see. So the first one we discussed about the amblyopia, yeah, or it's called as the lazy eye. The second is strabismus or the squint, it's called as the crossed eye. Third one, we saw the refractive errors. These, there is no any problem like what is called a major problem, because in strabismus and squint and all you have to do some corrective surgeries. There is physically a problem in the eye, but here you don't have that. It's because of our mistake, you're not taken proper care of eye, this happens. Yeah. So in refractive errors you have the short sightedness, long sightedness, and something called as presbyopia, where there is an extra layer in the eyes, cornea. Yeah, these are the common eye problems. Apart from this, some other common eye problems which affect the childhood, we are going to discuss that now. Conjunctivitis, most of them we call it as Madras eye. Yeah, it's called as the pink eye. So the other word for this conjunctivitis is pink eye. Here, there is an inflammation in the eye. Here the conjunctiva, the white part, whatever you are seeing, it gets totally inflamed. It's usually, they say, is because of some viral infection. And conjunctivitis, once it comes, there's no to take any treatment or anything as such. And this is highly contagious. If one person is having, you just see that person, you also get. It's highly transmittable. So if you have conjunctivitis, they advise to wear a black specs or a goggles, right? So this conjunctivitis, there is an eyelid inflammation, and this takes at least a week to 10 days to subside. So once it subsides by itself. So only for the irritation, they just give some drops just to reduce the irritation. That's it. Yeah, this is also very common. And some of the eye injuries. Eye injuries are quite common in the early childhood. Yeah, eye injury can be because of sports injury, or a child carrying a sharp pencil or a scissor if it's not been carried properly. So for this, the child has to be given with all the safety instructions, how to carry sharp objects, how to handle them, okay, what to be done and what not to be done to avoid these fatal accidents. So apart from that, sports injuries, misuse of toys, falls, damage from everyday tools and objects, exposure to harmful household products, car or vehicle accidents, and firework mishaps. These all can cause eye injuries. For this, no treatment, you have to just avoid. Take proper precaution, I mean avoid all these injuries. Apart from this, another one, a most important one, which is because of this vitamin A deficiency. What happens because of this vitamin A deficiency? As you all know, vitamin A is very, very important for the normal vision of the eye. What it does? It's very important for the night vision. Vitamin A, it produces something called as retinol. Okay? Produces something called as retinol, which is very, very important for the retinal pigments. It's a retinal pigment basically. So it's very, very important for the dark and the dim vision, especially the night vision. So the vitamin A, we'll discuss this in detail in the next chapter. I'm just going to give you a gist of it. What happens if the vitamin A has been not been given in proper amount to the child? These pigments are not developed. And usually for normal vision, color vision especially, you need to have rods and cones which are present in the eyes. All are brushing up with your science. Huh? You see, yeah. You have something called as rods and cones. So that has to be in its normal quantity. It has to be released in its normal quantity for the color vision. Yeah. So, and for this, vitamin A is very much essential. The retinol especially. Retinal pigments. Yeah. And if the vitamin A is deficient, what happens is, usually the first symptom is night blindness. The child comes up with night blindness, or they'll have this color blindness. They cannot differentiate between the colors, the primary colors, the secondary colors. They cannot differentiate between the colors. Then you have to immediately think of the vitamin A deficiency. And usually even our government is spending crores and crores of rupees for this vitamin A. They give the drops, just like the polio drops, they give this retinal drops also. Yeah, and it's very common. You don't see most of the cases here, but it's very common when you go to the village side. Any malnutrited child, they have this vitamin A deficiency, and this, if it is not being treated, it can, night blindness is the initial symptom, then it can lead to total blindness. It progresses to partial blindness, then if it is not corrected, total blindness. And this is one treatable cause of blindness. Not to go to that level. If you detect it in the early stages, if you give the vitamin A supplements to the child, vitamin A drops and the foods rich in vitamin A, it reverts back. Okay? Normal vision will be restored, 100%. But if it has been skipped, you cannot, huh? Not black and white, they'll get confused with the colors. They can't detect those colors. Got it? Yeah? So these are some of the common childhood eye problems. So we have discussed about this now. Now we'll discuss how to assess these eye problems. Yeah. How do you assess that the child is having an eye problem? Usually child does not come out and say that I am having some eye problem. Conjunctivitis, yeah, of course you can make out because there will be redness in the eye. Yeah. So usually they show it with some manifestations. Sitting posture. Yeah. Their behaviors. What they do if the vision is not normal? They turn their head like this, or they move their neck, or they see like this. Yeah, they try to adapt themselves to have a better vision. Yeah, and what they do is, and sometimes you can even observe some physical problems also in the eye, just like this squint or strabismus. It becomes very obvious that the child is having a crossed eye. Sometimes in the pupil you can see some white spot. So white spot, or just next to the cornea, you have this triangular spots or some white discoloration, which becomes very obvious, some glossy, it's very translucent in nature. That means it's because of vitamin A deficiency. There are some physical things which you can check in the eye, physical things which you cannot check, it's been taken up with the behaviors of the child. Yeah. And usually if the child is having short sightedness, if it does not come up with that, and you, if you can just check his book, you find there is nothing written in the book because he was not able to see anything. Yeah? Then you are going to ask the child what was the problem. Why you were, did not write, then he'll come up with to say that I had a blurred vision, I could not see anything. The same child, when you make him sit in the front row, he'll be able to write. So you have to think there could be some eye problem. Clear? Yeah? Okay. So coming to treatment and prevention of eye problems. Treatment depends on the condition, depends on the what sort of eye problem the child has. It includes either corrective glasses or contact lenses or medications or surgery. I've discussed in the specific groups now. Yeah. So contact lenses, usually they avoid it in the early childhood. Usually they don't give. They recommend not to give any contact lenses because it causes irritation in the eye. It can lead to infection also. Yeah. So usually corrective glasses. Then learning Braille or using recorded books. Braille, you know, that's because for the blind. So in case if the vitamin A deficiency is not corrected and the child goes to the total blindness, they should be given with that. Or if the child is born with, if it's a blind child, there's no other go, it has to be taught with this Braille script. Yeah. Then some eye problems can be treated by providing adequate nutrition such as vitamin A, giving vitamin A supplements, increasing and every now and then, if you find that there is a vitamin A problem, deficiency, every month, initially if it's more, every month they give, then they reduce it to 3 months, then 6 months, and always give them supplements of vitamin A rich food. All the yellow vegetables, okay, yellow and orangish vegetables, they say it has good vegetables as well as fruits. It's rich in vitamin A. Yeah, like papaya, carrot, even that pumpkin. Yeah, these are all rich in, which are yellow and slightly orangish. They're very good in vitamin A. So you have to encourage the child to eat as much as possible all these foods. Then although some eye problems cannot be prevented, but others can, as you all know, what can be prevented, don't give them more your smartphones or iPhones so that you avoid that problem. Yeah, everybody gives, I know that, when we also do it, but you fix the time, maybe half an hour in the morning, half an hour in the evening. Morning if he goes to the school, okay, as soon as he comes from school, half an hour, then again half an hour, that's it, not more than that, and not continuous. If the child's eye starts watering, then you can definitely make out that he is having, his eyes have got strained. Watering eyes is a symptom of a strained eye. Yeah, the eyes start watering, even for you also, think that your eyes have got strained. So you need to definitely give rest to your eyes. Okay, some of the cases, as I told you, it's treatable in the early stages. So you have to recognize those cases and start with the proper treatment. You cannot do it, you have to just refer to that. Yeah. So these are the, some of the physical behavior of a child with eye problem. As I've already told, there could be some changes in the head position, face turn, head tilt, chin up or chin down, depending on what is the problem with the child, what vision he is not able to look properly, normal vision if he is not getting, he changes all these postures. There could be head lift or head down or chin up or chin down or face tilt, all those physical maneuvers he does. Yeah, and an abnormal head position may be used in the presence of reduced vision, nystagmus or shaking of eye, and strabismus. I didn't speak about nystagmus, right? Nystagmus, it's not very common, but sometimes it so happens. How many of you have seen this Kannada actor Upendra? Movie actor. What happens to his eyes? Sometimes it will be normal, but sudden movement, abrupt movement, eyes starts shaking like this. Yeah? That is nystagmus. Have you seen that? That is nystagmus. That's called as the shaking of eye. That's because of some sudden muscle contractions. normally it will be fine, yeah. Sometimes some movement, if the suddenly takes it to the right or left, it starts shaking. Before it comes to the normal, it takes 2 or 3 movements like this and then comes back to normal. That is shaking of eye. In nystagmus also, sometimes there will be blurred vision and there could be double vision. So double vision is called as diplopia in the medical term. Yeah, this is not that very common. That's why I have not mentioned over there. Yeah, these are some of the common eye problems. Any doubt? This much you need to know when you are a preschool teacher. Yeah, okay. Next, we'll go with this ENT problems. ENT problems are very, 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 very common in early childhood. How many of your kids had these problems? Only that many? Almost all of them would be having this problem. Yeah, ENT problem. ENT is always been considered as one single unit because ear, nose and throat, all these three are interlinked. Yeah? Any problem with the nose can lead a problem to the ears and even the throat. Yeah? Any infection in the throat can travel through the to the ears. Any infection in the ear can travel to the throat and even the nose. Yeah? Okay. And some of the common ENT problems. Blocked nose. Usually it's very, very common. Blocked nose. And usually if there is a blocked nose, this child starts breathing with the mouth. Yeah. So and this, what they say, it's the common cause is allergy. Now it is most of them, they have this blocked nose and mouth breathing. So the common cause is allergy. Apart from that, sinusitis, swollen turbinates, enlarged adenoids or tonsils. So what is the sinusitis? How many of you have sinusitis? Okay, please pass on the mic to them and I have to hear from them what are their problems. What happens in sinusitis?
Always heaviness in the head.
Heaviness in the head?
You are not able to bend the shoulder.
Yes.
Something is falling down.
Yes.
Climbing up or climbing down the steps. Something is shaking inside the head.
Shaking inside the head, yes.
Sneezing.
Sneezing. So almost all the symptoms she told. Those are the symptoms of sinusitis. So what is this sinusitis? Anywhere in a medical term, if this itis comes, even if doctor is telling something about itis in the end, if he is adding this itis in the end, that means he is indicating that there is some infection. Yeah, infection or inflammation. So here it is sinusitis. Sinus. What is a sinus? This sinus means nothing but a hole which can you can pass on in your skull. No, if you just see just the skull, if you put a thread in these holes, the thread comes out. These are small holes which are there in your skull bone. Okay, in your face bone and in your skull bone. These sinusitis. As she told, whenever there is a problem with sinusitis, they'll have this heaviness in the head. They'll have headache. They can't do any job. As soon as they bend, they feel that it's so heavy, and sometimes they even feel giddy. Yeah, and it usually happens when there is a cold. Cold, immediately they have this sinusitis. Okay, before I go to this, can anyone tell me what is your brain weight? What is the weight of a normal adult brain? 2.5 what?
Kg.
Kg? Then?
Gram.
Gram?
Gram.
Half kilo, okay. It's around 1.5 to 2 kgs. Can you feel that weight? 1.5 kg? When if you take 1.5 kg, can you feel that weight? No? But when you have a headache, feel that there is something, you feel like you have to bang on your head. You feel that they have kept one such big stone on your head. Yes? Yeah? It's especially more in sinusitis. or that leads to migraine. It's a severe headache. Yeah? Why you cannot know the weight of your brain? Normally, when you don't have any headache, when you are normal, you don't feel the weight of your brain. It's because of these sinuses. Because of these holes in your face bone and in your skull bone. You have two holes here, you have two holes here, okay? And you have two holes, very small, minor holes here in this zygomatic bone. So these holes, what it does is, it will reduce the pressure. Yeah? So sometimes what happens when you have this cold and your blocked nose, this is going to get blocked. These holes are blocked. So that's why you can feel the weight of your brain. You have that severe headache. Yeah? Okay. So, blocked nose and mouth breathing because of allergy, sinusitis, swollen turbinates. Turbinates are there in your nose here. Yeah? If it gets swollen, then that also causes blocked nose. Turbinates usually get swollen if you have cold. Then enlarged adenoids. Adenoids is just a small projection. Yeah? Just a small projection like this. If this is your nose, okay, this is the right and this is the left. You imagine this is your bone here. So there will be some small adenoids here. So these adenoids can cause blocked nose. Yeah, these adenoids are just small growth. This has to be taken out. They usually surgically do it because it cannot be treated with the medications and all. Or tonsils. Even in case of tonsils, you have this blocked nose. Tonsils is nothing but the infection in your throat. Here also you have this swollen glands. Yeah. Huh? Adenoids, they say it's just an extra growth. Yeah, the soft tissues. It's just an extra growth. Yeah, runny nose, and it's usually very, very common in the early childhood. Most of the kids will have this runny nose. It's because of the allergy. Yeah, and once they have this runny nose or cold, it usually subsides by itself. It might take 15 to 20 days, or some it prolongs to a month. Even if you don't give any treatment, it will subside by itself because it's just a viral infection, and whatever medications you are giving, it's never going to help him. It's only for our satisfaction we give. Yeah? Okay. Next, chronic cough. So, here why they've given us chronic cough is, it's because of all these, what happens? The next stage, if the child is having cold, he ends up with cough. Usually it's a cycle. So cold and then cough and then fever. Cold, cough, fever. Cold, cough, fever. Yeah? So why they call it as chronic cough here is, very often if he is getting, every 2 months once, 3 months once, 4 months once, it usually happens as soon as there is a weather change. If some child in the school is having cold, he picks it up. Because it's viral, it gets transmitted. Yeah? Okay. And this chronic cough should be evaluated. It might be because of an upper respiratory tract infection or either a lower respiratory tract infection. Usually most of the times it's URTI, that is upper respiratory tract infection. It's because secondary to this allergy, secondary to this cold. Yeah? Sinusitis, I've already discussed now. Sore throat. It's usually because of the pharyngitis or the tonsillitis. You have this irritation in your throat here. So that's called as the sore throat. And when you see, you will have this redness. When the doctor asks you to say, ah, that's all, you can see that redness in the pharynx. Okay. And usually they give an antibiotic for this, so usually subsides. It's all secondary. Because of this cold, ended up with sore throat. Okay. Now, coming to the specific ear problems. What are the specific ear problems? Ear infections. This is the first and the foremost and the most important one. and it's very common ear infections in children. So what they say is ear infection is the second most commonest after the common cold. And ear infection, 30 to 50% of children by 4 years of age will have an infection in the ear at least once. And in ear infection also, you have something called as this middle ear infection. Yeah? And it is called as the otitis media. If it happens immediately, it is called as acute otitis media. If the same episode has been repeating for a long time, it's called as chronic otitis media. So this is the middle ear infection. As you all know, your ear is divided into three parts. One is outer ear, which you can see here, and the outer ear is connected to the inner ear through this middle ear. Yeah, and the inner ear is basically helps in the, it takes up the auditory impulses, it takes up the auditory frequencies, and you have something called a hair like structure over there which recognizes the signal. Ultimate is the brain, ultimately it goes to the brain. And apart from that, ear is a very important organ for the balance. Yeah, ear is a very important structure for the balance. In case if you see you have the small hair like projections in your ear, which is called as villi in the inner ear. So any change in the movement of the villi of the ear, it causes giddiness. Apart from the cerebellum, apart from the brain, ear is also plays an important role in balance. So that's why any ear infections, middle ear infection, if it has progressed to the inner ear, it causes a problem in the balance also, apart from the hearing deficits. Yeah, okay. So what is this middle ear infection? It's usually because of the bacterial infection. Yeah, how this happens very often, whenever the child is having this cold, from the nose it travels to the ear. How it travels to the ear? You have something called as an Eustachian tube. So that tube connects the nose to the middle ear. So through that tube it travels to the middle ear. And in the middle ear, what happens, especially in children, because the middle ear, that Eustachian tube is horizontal. Okay, actually it should be sliding like this. What happens, whatever secretion has traveled through the Eustachian tube, it remains there for a long time and it starts getting infected. That's why they have this ear infections very often. Got the point? It's too much, huh? Okay. How many of your children had ear infection? Anytime? They had? So this is what usually happens. They complain pain in the ear. Sometimes they has to be taken proper care. That's why if the child is having severe high fever associated with cough, hacking cough, and the respiratory rate is more, kindly get it checked and start with the antibiotic cover. That's why what they say, even if, because we cannot differentiate between an URTI and an LRTI. You never know when it is going to turn to an LRTI. That's why to be on the safer side, always start off with the antibiotic cover, just to avoid this pneumonia. Got it? Yeah? Okay. Apart from this, these are the other infections, that is tuberculosis. Tuberculosis, it's a bacterial infection, it's because of the Mycobacterium tubercle, and this is highly contagious. Until unless the treatment is started for this tuberculosis, it's highly contagious. Any person, if he is affected with TB, it can happen in any age group. Let it be child or let it be an adult, can happen in any age group. Even if a child is having, if your immunity is compromised at that stage, even you can also contract with TB. But one good thing is you have 100% cure for this. Only thing is you have to take a proper treatment. So apart from this, the other causes of lung respiratory problems, exposure to cigarette smoke, either active smoking or passive smoking, both can have respiratory problems. Active smoking by a person, passive smoking if somebody in the home they are smoking, in front of the kids, or even you are also inhaling the same quantity of nicotine. Okay. Then blockage of airway by an inhaled object such as food, balloon or small toy, etc. Very, 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 very common in the early childhood. Yeah. Small, small things, what they do? Experiment. They just put in their nose and that can cause a block. So I'll just tell about that in the respiratory emergencies now. Okay. Apart from this, genetic causes like cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis is not common here. It's very common in the Western community. This is because of some genetic disorder where the entire lung gets fibrosed. There will be no space for the air exchange at all. Yeah. Then exposure to airborne pollution. Very, very common nowadays. All metro cities, they are facing this problem. Yeah. Respiratory emergencies, you need to know how to react, what you have to do. Because these are all emergency situation, you can't wait for somebody to come in and act. You need to immediately act. Yeah. So what are these respiratory emergencies? If the child is choking with an object in the windpipe, breathing might stop in 10 to 20 seconds. And there could be moderate to severe difficulty in breathing. It could be because some particle if he is inserting in his nose or some particle he has ingested. Both can lead to choking. Yeah? What are you going to do immediately? And okay, we'll discuss what are these respiratory emergencies first and then we'll go to that. So this is one. What? Respiratory emergency. These are all considered as respiratory emergencies. Which one? Choking. First. It can be because of something which has blocked the nose here or something which the child has ingested, small goli type of a thing or something, small balls and all. It is ingested, it has blocked the passage here, food pipe or the windpipe here. Okay. That's a respiratory emergency. Wheezing, which is lasting for more than an hour. If there is the wheezing, as I told you in asthma, the child or even if the adult, if he is having wheezing for more than 1 hour, that is also considered to be an respiratory emergency. And you're going to look in this is grey, mottled or blue skin present on the finger or the nail beds, lips or the earlobes. These are all the signs of choking. Choking, usually immediately you don't have this. If it is there for more than an hour, the child is suffering with this wheezing for more than an hour, you'll have this bluish discoloration on your nail beds. Bluish discoloration of the skin. Okay? And grey mottled sputum also. When if there is a sputum which is coming out, it becomes grey and mottled. That also itself, it's showing an indication that the oxygen has not been supplied for a quite long time. Yeah? Oxygen has not been supplied, matlab, some problem in the exchange. Got it? Got the point? What I am trying to tell you? Then some may present with drooling, with troubled breathing, or the child is not able to make sounds or cry. These are all the signs what you are going to look for. When the child is having this drooling and is breathing from the mouth, he is not able to express, he is not able to tell anything. Immediately you have to think that the child has ingested something, it has inhaled something. Immediately you need to act. What are you going to do? Okay. First and the foremost thing, the temperature of the room should be very comfortable. It should not be very hot or very dry, or if there is a nasal congestion, take it out. In case of a respiratory emergency, immediately what you are going to do is just look around the things. And that's why any child should not be left alone. Always one of the attendants should be there with the child. That's why if the class, as a class teacher, if you are not present, you are going to give the responsibility to the ayah and then go. If you have some job, please ask somebody just to watch the class and then go. Okay? Kids are very naughty. Any small things, what they do, just experimenting, they put it in the nose or they just try to ingest it. So, if the child is not able to speak, if it is blocked, if you see the child is struggling to take a breath, immediately you think that he might have taken something. just see, look around, or ask the person, ask any other child, did you see him taking something? Yeah, any person, whoever is available. They say, yeah, he was playing with the small beads, they immediately think that he has had something. So what you have to do is check manually. If it is there in the nose, usually if you block the other nose and try to just blow it, it usually comes out. Yeah? Usually God has given us such a gift that anything, if you try to just push it, you sneeze. That's a reflex. Usually comes out with sneezing. But some people, some children, what they do, they put it into so deep that they bypass the sneezing reflex also. Yeah? It would have gone into the turbinates here. If it has gone into the turbinates, it will just blow the nose and see whether it is coming out. If it is not coming out, what you have to do is try to just, yeah, you have to make the child the head down and the legs up. Try to see if it is dropping down. If it is not happening, immediately you have to shift him to an hospital. Yeah, sometimes it so happens from the nose, it comes to the mouth. If it has come to the mouth, you can just throw it out. If it has not come to the mouth, it has just blocked over here. Even after this manoeuvre, it's not coming out. You don't manually do it because you're pushing it again. Got it? If it is visible, if you have some any small thing, if you can just pull it out, you try, just try and pull it out if it's possible. If it's not possible, please don't do it. Got the point? Okay. This is with the nasal. In case if the child has ingested something, if he has had something through his mouth, it is blocked over here. So usually the first symptom is that the child will not be able to speak. He's trying to tell something. This will be his maneuver. That's it. What you're going to do is immediately ask the child to open his mouth. If you can see something, if it is in the approachable level, just try to take it out manually. If it cannot be taken out manually, don't do it. If it has gone already here, again, if you put your hand, finger, okay, what's going to happen? Because of the panic and because of the tension, anxiety, the child ingests inside. So once it goes to the windpipe, it can block the windpipe. What you're going to do is immediately, you can try something called as a helmic maneuver, or if it's a very small child, turn it upside down and try to give some pats on his neck here, okay? Just two or three paths. Even in that case, if it's not happening, what you're going to do is you're going to try this helmic maneuver. How do we do this is one person, if you just can just come down here with your chair. Come, Nishtha. These are all the first aids what you're doing. Yeah. First of all, you don't get panicked and don't make the child also anxious. Just console him that nothing has happened, it's fine. I'll just try to help you out. What you're going to do is, just make the child sit like this, relaxed, go to the front. Yeah. You have to put your thumb this way. Huh? What you're going to do is, Nishtha has a lot of protection, so it's very difficult for me to do. Yeah. So you're going to have your thumb this way. What you're going to do, your thumb should be pointed upwards. What you're going to do is, just imagine she is a child, okay? Take a deep breath. Try to take a deep breath, Nishtha. If the child cannot, don't worry, okay? Then what you're going to do is, you're going to give a, during exhalation, you're going to give a sudden thrust here. Yeah? You're going to give a sudden thrust here. Five. So five times you're going to do that. One, two, three, four, five. It usually regurgitates out. Yeah? It regurgitates out. So you are giving a pressure just underneath the diaphragm. Yeah? So, and this has to be done during the exhalation. Exhalation in the sense during the exhalation phase. Yeah? If you can't find out the exhalation phase and inhalation phase, no worries. The first thing is that has to come out. So what you are going to do is, just put your hand inside and try to give the thrust. She has to be bent like this. The gravity also assists this. या हिज हेयर थोड़ा सा लूज ओके जस्ट डाउन दिस वे एंड यू गोइंग टू गिव अ सडन थ्रस्ट हियर गॉट इट सो दिस वन मैनेवर यू आर गोइंग टू ट्राई इफ दिस इज नॉट हैपनिंग व्हाट यू गोइंग टू डू इज टर्न हेड अपसाइड डाउन टर्न द चाइल्ड अपसाइड डाउन एंड ट्राई टू जस्ट गिव थ्रस्ट हियर जस्ट अंडरनीथ द डायफ्राम ट्राई टू जस्ट गिव द थ्रस्ट इफ दिस इज ऑल्सो नॉट हैपनिंग डोंट टेक एनी चांस immediately shift because you are just wasting time usually with this maneuver it comes out any particle it usually comes out with this maneuver okay if it's not coming out immediately shifting otherwise if something goes wrong it will be on your head yeah yeah thank you Nishtha these are all the respiratory emergencies which has to be taken care of the best thing is try and avoid it how to avoid it Your presence is must there. Got it? Yeah? Okay. So apart from that, these are all the normal treatment for the respiratory problems. So what you are going to do is the temperature should be as comfortable. Then prevent dehydration by encouraging the child to take as much fluid as possible. Water. So encourage the child to take as much water as possible to reduce the viscosity of the mucus. To reduce the thickness of the mucus so that it comes out easily and this even reduces the fever also then use a vaporizer or a humidifier nebulizer what we call so instead of going for an a cough syrup or something if you use those nebulizers na that's very much effective because it's directly going to the lungs yeah it does not take a systemic route it directly goes to the lungs And you can use some saline nasal drops for nasal congestion and give the child antihistaminics or decongestants until unless suggested by a physician and appropriate use of antibiotics whenever it is required. These are just the normal treatment what we are going to give. Respiratory emergencies I have already told. So if you find the child still choking even after this, please immediately call an ambulance. If you are seeing that the child has become cyanosed, I mean bluish discoloration is already there, then it becomes very difficult. Because it's only 3 minutes that the brain can sustain without oxygen. If it's more than 3 minutes, the brain cannot sustain. Ultimately, it goes to hypoxia and the child might die. Okay? So be very careful. Yeah. So prevention. What is the prevention? What all you can do is you have to reduce the exposures to all these allergens. It's quite difficult. Yeah, cannot do it. Okay. Anyway, try to do as much as possible. Try to prevent those infections. Then you have to wash the hands. Try to avoid the transmission of infection. Usually, transmission happens through hands. So, if any child in the class is having So before they start their tiffins, thorough washing of hands, all these preventive measures has to be taken care of. Then vaccinations. Vaccinations are very important. So like this diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, haemophilus influenza type B. See to that the child gets these compulsory vaccinations. Yeah. Apart from this, to avoid breastfeed the baby for at least 6 months after birth. When it comes to the preschool and they're in the school, you cannot do anything. But this has to be, the mother has to be given proper knowledge about this. Because if the baby is exclusively breastfed for 6 months, his immunity power would be very, very good. Okay, not bottle-fed babies. Breastfed babies have better immunities than the bottle-fed babies. And if the child is sick, separate him from other children. Do not smoke or use tobacco products in front of children. And avoid giving young children the food or objects that may be improperly swallowed and inhaled and avoid exposure to dust and air pollutants by wearing protective masks okay we'll just take a break for 5 to 10 minutes and then we'll continue these are the respiratory problems any doubt clear these many things as a parent also you need to know respiratory emergencies how to act Yeah. Any doubts with the respiratory problems, whatever we discussed in the morning? Eyes, ears, respiratory, dermatology, any problem? No? Okay. Next, gastrointestinal problems. Gastrointestinal problems are very, very common in children again. Okay? There are lots of variants in this. So one is diarrhea. So it can happen. Why is diarrhea happening? Actually, basically, it's because of consumption of contaminated food. Yeah? Okay. So, and usually in the early 5 years, whenever a child is attending a daycare, they have seen the incidences are more diarrhea because of the practices. They don't take hygienic precautions. So the diarrhea is common over there. Yeah. And diarrhea, what they say is because of this diarrhea, there were around 2.5 million deaths in a year in a preschool children throughout the world. So why there is death because of this diarrhea? Very simple condition. And why there is death? Dehydration. So because of the dehydration, there are deaths reported in diarrhea. Not only children, even because of dehydration, death can happen even in adults also, if it is not taken proper care of. Okay, why it happens? Because basically our body is made up of fluids, lots and lots and lots of fluids. Yeah? Okay. In diarrhea, what happens? There is a profound loss of fluid. And our body cells are not adjusted for this sudden loss of fluid. Yeah? There will be an imbalance in the extracellular fluid and the intracellular fluid balance. Whenever there is the fluid which is coming out, if the diarrhea is, say the child is going more than 10 to 15 times in a day, if he is passing loose motions and if he is having repeatedly vomiting also, then he is losing the fluid from either sides. Yeah? So you have to immediately replenish the fluid. You have to immediately replace it with the fluid. If you're not replacing it, the cells are going to shrink. Yeah? If you're not replacing it with the fluid, the cells are going to shrink. And this shrinkage can cause the heart cells to stop beating. Yeah? So that's how the heart stops beating and there is a sudden cardiac arrest and the child dies. If this diarrhea is not taken care of. The treatment is very, very, very simple. ORS, simple oral rehydration therapy. What you're going to do is 1 spoon of salt and sugar. You can either have 1.5 spoon of sugar and maybe 3/4 spoon of salt. So this salt and sugar is going to balance. Sugar, what it's going to do is it's going to give the glucose. It's going to give the energy to the cell. Salt is going to replenish the lost sodium. Sodium which is lost in the motions. Okay. And apart from this, you have to even replenish with the potassium also. Because the immediate potassium loss can cause the heart muscle to fatigue. It makes the heart muscle weak. Okay. So there is an immediate fatigue in the heart muscle. So if you don't replenish with potassium, it's going to go for a cardiac arrest. Cardiac arrest means nothing but it's heart attack. Okay? This happened recently with one of my relative. She just had around 6 to 7 times of diarrhea in the night. I mean evening it started, and in the morning when they had taken her to the hospital, they did not. Maybe she was not given with the rehydration therapy because it was in the night. They didn't take proper care of it. What happened? The next morning, she had a sudden cardiac arrest and she passed away. Just 2 months back. Not even 2 months, it's 1.5 months back. Yeah, you need to take a proper precaution of this. And she was just 56 years old, that's it. In middle age. But it's because of this sudden dehydration. Yeah, that's why in children the incidence is more because the surface area is less. You have to take proper precaution. Immediately, one or two times if there is loose motion, immediately start with rehydration therapy. Don't wait. So how do you make out that the child has dehydrated? If you hold a skin crease in this groin region, it becomes dry. You won't get that pinch. You just get the skin, okay? And it becomes dry. You don't have that pinch. That's how they check the diarrhea. That's how they check the rehydration status. Okay. Now, next thing is constipation. One is diarrhea, that is loss, and constipation, because they eat a lot of this junk foods and all, they get constipation. Yeah? And it's like when you call it, if the child has not passed stools for more than 3 to 4 days, it gets constipated. It gets hard and it becomes very difficult for the child to pass motion. So what we do is start off with the ask him to take lots and lots and lots of fluid or water so that the stool loosens out. So if it's not happening, you have to start with the diet which is rich in fiber content. Even if it's not happening, you give him an local, either you can start with the stool loosening agents you get, like the scrimafin and all those things. So if, in that case also, if it's not happening, what you're going to do is, you're going to loosen the stool by giving him local, through the anus, you're going to give him the laxatives, so that it loosened out and it comes out. It usually common in children, bottle fed children. Very, very common. Constipation is very common in bottle fed infants. Constipation? Fiber food? Some people know the bowel movements. Genetically, it happens. If the movement is slow, okay, there is constipation. लार्ज बाउल मूवमेंट जो है ना अगर वो स्लो है तो कॉन्स्टिपेशन हो जाए. ओके या एंड नेक्स्ट वन इज गैस्ट्रो इसोफेजियल रिफ्लक्स. सो व्हाट इज दिस गैस्ट्रो इसोफेजियल रिफ्लक्स? दिस इज द रीगर्जिटेशन ऑफ द फूड कंटेंट्स व्हाट एवर द चाइल्ड इज कंज्यूमिंग. And it's usually seen more when the child is having food rich in acidic food. Like they have this Coke and the chips, Kurkure and all those things, all those stuff. They have this acid regurgitation. Even we do have it sometimes. So, but it's very common in children because the sphincter. So what happens is, if this is the food pipe, this is the stomach. Yeah. You have a sphincter here. And you have a sphincter here also. This is the food pipe. The child has ingested. It has gone into this esophagus. It has entered the stomach here. And the mixing process starts here. The acidic juices and all. Right. So during this process, what happens? As soon as the food enters, this sphincter, it opens and the food enters. And this has to immediately close. So the food does not regurgitate back. Okay? But it is seen in some children, because it's not fully developed, this might not close fully. There's slight opening there. Okay. So constipation we've discussed, gastroesophageal reflex, as I was telling, it's because of the improper closure of this sphincter. Okay? And there is acid reflux. What happens? If it is quite often, it's going to inflame this entire esophagus. That entire esophageal lining gets infected or inflamed. They'll have this. Okay? Acidity, what we call it, it's almost, but in children, it's because of this. And how do you avoid this? Stop giving them food which has this acidic contents. Either Coke or this Kurkure, chips and all those, you can give it but not very often. Restrictions, yeah, and we all like to have those foods, but you can take it in a proper manner, that's it. Not every time having that Kurkure, daily you empty one Coke bottle. Yeah, that's going to lead to this gastroesophageal reflux. Repeatedly it keeps on happening means the entire esophageal lining is going to get destroyed. Once it gets destroyed, it cannot be, you won't get that natural thing back. That's it. So then, yes. Tobacco, what happens, it's going to destroy that entire lining. That entire lining it's going to destroy. So once it destroys that entire lining, that protective layer is lost, na? Okay. So apart from this, whatever we've discussed, the important ones, these are some of the other common childhood illnesses which is seen. The first one is malaria. Malaria is quite very common, and you have that malaria endemic areas in India also. If you just go beyond from Bangalore, say around 30-40 kilometers, you have this malaria endemic area. That entire area is prone to malaria. At least once in their lifetime or twice in their lifetime, they would have got malaria. Okay? So it's like that. So, near to Kolar. So malaria is because of what? Mosquito bite. A female Anopheles mosquito bite. So what happens is this produces high fever, you have headaches, you have vomiting and other flu-like symptoms. And usually the common manifestation of malaria is you'll be having fever in the evenings. Mornings and all they'll be fine, but evening they'll have chills and fever. They'll have chills and fever. So the treatment is, first of all, stop mosquito breeding. So what you have to do is clean that entire area. So keep that, maintain that area properly. So if you have already contacted with malaria, you can't do anything, you have to go for anti-malarial therapy. Yeah, and this can be life-threatening. Why? Because this malaria can kill by infecting and destroying the red blood cells, and this leads to anemia. When it comes to the child, because as you know, everything is compromised in a child, it's not very well developed. So it can cause severe anemia, severe loss of red blood cells. If the red blood cells are lost, the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood is totally compromised. Okay. And apart from that, it can also clog the capillaries that carry blood to the brain, which is called as cerebral malaria. Have you heard of this? Cerebral malaria? Malaria affecting brain? What happens? So if it is severe, it has not been taken care of, it has not been treated, it can cause cerebral malaria, brain fever, sort of brain fever. Usually encephalitis is called as brain fever, but in this cerebral malaria, what happens is, so it's going to affect the brain, and once it affects the brain, the child will definitely have some morbidity, some disability later. It can even die also because of that high fever and chills, and it can have permanent some morbidity. Okay, that's why malaria has to be taken care of properly. So if the child is showing symptoms of malaria, they immediately start with anti-malarial treatment. And it's very easy, and it cures 100%. No problem with that. Then measles. Measles is again a viral infection. So to avoid this measles, compulsorily the child has to be vaccinated against this measles. You get this measles vaccine, measles, mumps, rubella, that's a combination vaccine. Apart from this, you have a measles vaccine also separately. So these are all compulsory vaccinations which the child has to get. Okay, measles mein kya hota hai, you have this running nose, cough, conjunctivitis and high fever, and this is again contagious in nature, matlab it can spread. Okay, and leading to a skin rash. And complications from measles can occur immediately and almost in every organ system. What happens, measles keval, it doesn't have this flu like symptoms. Apart from that, it can even affect the organs if it is severe. Okay, it can cause pneumonia, croup or encephalitis. Encephalitis, as I told you, is a brain fever. Encephalitis matlab the entire brain gets damaged, and here the fever goes up to 107, 108, 109. हाई फीवर यू कैन आप रोटी भी सेक सकते हो उनके ऊपर इतना गर्म रहता है. व्हेन आई वाज वर्किंग इन निमहांस व्हेन वी हैड गॉन फॉर आवर इंटर्नशिप इन निमहांस आई सॉ अ वेरी स्मॉल गाय आई मीन ही वाज वेरी यंग हाउ मच मे बी अराउंड 11 इयर्स और 10 इयर्स और 11 इयर्स ही हैड दिस एनकेफलाइटिस वी कुड नॉट इवन टच हिम एंड ब्रेन फीवर the chances of survival is less, minimal. Depends on the therapy. Very high antibiotics, IV antibiotics has to be given. Since it's a viral, it doesn't help out much. Okay? So what you can do is avoid. How can you avoid? Vaccinations. Measles come. Okay? And don't let it increase. So if the child is having measles, try to isolate him so that it is not spread to others and start with symptomatic relief therapy. Okay? Then? It might come, but the severity would be very less. It won't go to this severity, encephalitis and all. HIV or AIDS? HIV or AIDS, which has become common nowadays. It was not there earlier. And HIV and AIDS. HIV is different and AIDS is different. You must be knowing it, right? So HIV is human. What? What? HIV. It's because of the something called as, it's a viral infection, which is called as human immunodeficiency virus. And this HIV is just one thing. AIDS is one manifestation of HIV. That's it. In HIV, you have lots of other variants, HIV 1, 2 and all those things. You have lots of variants. HIV, what happens is, here there is a total compromise in the immunity because of this virus. And you know how it spreads. It can spread because of the sexual contact or unsterile needle practices. And drug addicts, usually they use the same needle, yeah, and even the blood, if your blood gets contaminated with an HIV positive patient or a person, so then also it can happen, yeah. And with the razors, what they use, if it's been used to an HIV positive person and if it's been used to a normal person, skin contact, okay. Should be very, 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 very careful with this. It does not mean that HIV jinko aa gaya hai, wo immediately, next step is they are going to die. It's not that. So HIV people also, positive people also, they can survive for 20-25 years.
45
years. No, no, what I'm telling you, if they have got infected maybe by around 20-25 years, if they follow a proper life, how to lead the life and how to prevent, how to make themselves like with this nutrition and all those things and the medications, proper medications, they can survive for more than 25-30 years also. That's a normal lifespan of a person. Yeah? Okay. Anyway, so we should not get that. What I'm telling you is, this HIV, when it comes to when you're discussing about the preschool, the first and the foremost thing in the earlier in the class I discussed during pregnancy. If the mother is having HIV positive, then it should not enter to the child. So what we call it as mother-child transmission, that has to be stopped. So they usually give a vaccination which blocks the transmission of HIV virus through the placenta to the baby, fetus. Okay? So they give that vaccination and they start with the antiretroviral drugs. Now they claim that they have found a drug for HIV, but it's still under the research. Okay. Then, what is this? Yeah. So, how to reduce the impact of HIV on children? Early diagnosis is a requisite and the child should receive good nutrition, appropriate immunization and drug therapy for treating common childhood infections. So, if the person is already known with HIV, whatever problems he is facing, just start treating for all those and try to isolate. There is no, for touching alone, it doesn't spread. So, and even sharing food also doesn't spread. It only spreads through direct contact. That's it. Okay. Any doubts with this? And AIDS is totally different. It's an acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. Because of this HIV, they have acquired this immunodeficiency syndrome. The manifestations can be in any ways. Yeah, skin manifestation, whatever treatment they are giving for any problems is not getting better for a long time, then you can think of this. Yeah? Thank you. So this chapter is over, chapter 3, which is common childhood illness. This many things, if you know, it's too much for you people. That's enough. Any doubts in whatever we have covered now? No? Clear? Next chapter also, chapter 4 is little bit lengthy. I'll try to make it a little short for you people. And after that, it's all very common. Next chapter, this is in child psychology, don't get confused. This is special education. In our last class, we have discussed about the various types of learning disorders. Yeah? So how to handle those children, how to identify those children, how to assess learning disability. Actually, you are all turning pages and seeing it, huh? Okay. So this is special education. Special education needs, if you can see that. Yeah? Okay. What do you mean by this special education? Or special children? Or special education needs for these children? Anyone want to share your ideas? What do you mean by this special education or special children or special education needs? In the last class, we've discussed about the learning disorders. Some of them would also come in this. Why it would come, I'll tell you. But even in this, yeah, it's on.
Is it for autistic children?
Autistic children, yes. What I'm asking you is, whom do you call as a special children? Or a special needs children?
Whose milestones are not on time, probably they need, you know, special instruction when compared to the normal yes. children.
Okay. Then?
They need extra time.
They need extra time and extra support. They can't do without assistance. Yeah. Others will not be audible.
Everything is depend on activity.
Activity.
Activity. What they see and observe and learn.
You can't tell them as special children, na?
Special children.
Hmm? Anybody? As she rightly said, anything for a normal child, you don't need to have any modifications. You don't need to do any changes. Yeah? You don't need to deviate from your normalcy, whatever you're teaching or whatever planning you're doing. Yeah? But for these special children or special needs children, you have to do some deviations. Yes or no? Okay? They are all special needs children. They need something extra. They can't cope up with the normal thing, what a normal child does. If a normal child is capable of understanding everything in one go, these children might take a little longer time. Yeah? Or they may take, or they may be very much at par with the normal child. That's a gifted child. They are also special needs because you can't put them into a normal class. Got it? Which, these are children who require something little extra. Something different from the normal child. Okay? So now we'll discuss in this chapter, what are the special needs children? Yeah, so special needs is a term used in clinical diagnostic and functional development to describe individuals who require assistance for disabilities that may be either medical, mental or psychological. So according to this, we are going to consider them as special children. Okay, they need assistance either medically. Medically in the sense, they have some congenital problems, they have some problems. So lifelong they are on some medications. These are also special needs children. Got it? For example, children with epileptic seizures or convulsions, fits, jinko aate hain. Yeah? So these children, they need some alterations in the way you do anything for them. Yeah? So those are medical or mental. In case if the child is mentally retarded or if he is an autistic child or if he is a CP child, you need to do some changes, right? That also. Or psychological. Psychological, when it comes to the socio-emotionally, socially and emotionally the child is disturbed, or if he is having some hearing disturbance or visual impairment, all these also will come under the special needs category. What's the point? Even to some extent, the learning disability people come into the special needs category because they need something extra. Like for example, a dyslexic child. He will not be very comfortable with the normal schooling method. He need a special schooling method for that. That's also a special need child. Got it? It does not mean ki he is mentally retarded. So you have to be very clear with the definition when you are speaking about the special need child. He just needs something extra, something special. That's it. Clear? Okay. So whom all you can categorize into this? People with autism. So I had told you in the last class also, people with autism. In autism, there is a neurological change. Neurological damage is there, present. Okay. Apart from that, the child, he doesn't like to interact with others. Socially, he loves to be alone. Right? He does not have an eye-to-eye contact. And these autistic children, they need special pattern of teaching. They need some special attention. So you can't accommodate them in the normal classroom. It's mild, yeah. Otherwise, you always have to give some special attention to that child. Okay? Autism. Then Down syndrome. What is Down syndrome? Down syndrome is a congenital disorder. It's a genetic disorder where you have a trisomy. So usually you have how many pairs of chromosomes?
24.
I think I had told this in the earlier class also, if I remember. Yes, I had told. 23 pairs of chromosomes. So you have 23 pairs of chromosomes, in that 22 are autosomes and one is a sex chromosome, one pair is a sex chromosome. So in this Down syndrome what happens, you have trisomy, that is 22 plus 1 plus 1. They have some extra chromosome genetically. And these Down syndrome children, they have some mental retardation also. Okay, and this is, since it's a genetic disorder, it cannot be corrected. And Down syndrome, you can usually make out if the child is a Down syndrome child. They usually have a totally different feature from a normal child. They have this Mongolian face, just like a monkey-like face. The eyebrows and all will not be visible. They'll have no eyebrows, no creases in the hand, and they'll have short stature. Okay? They'll be a little plumpy. So these are all the symptoms of Down syndrome, and these children also need some special help. They can't accommodate with the normal children because they have a mild degree of mental retardation. Pa, I think he was not a Down syndrome child. I have not seen that movie actually. No, I'm telling you, I have not, because I can't tell you, I have not seen that movie. I don't think so he was a Down syndrome child. Down syndrome you can easily make out. I didn't get an image.
We have a friend in Far Home. He is very intelligent. He is very intelligent, but he was physically a problem.
Okay. So I have no idea about that.
Actually, a small
can't
child
comment.
Looks like a young man.
Yeah, a small child will look like a young man, and his face and all will be different.
Yeah.
Even the hair will be brownish. Yeah, hair will be brownish. It will be short stature. There will be no creases at all. Okay? And there will be slow cerebration. That means he can't react immediately. He can't react to things. He always needs an assistance. They can't usually go to a normal schooling because of some amount of mental retardation in them. Then cerebral palsy. What is a cerebral palsy? Cerebral palsy, as I've discussed, this also you have lot of different types of cerebral palsies. It depends on the insult to the brain. Matlab kitna damage hua hai, kahan damage hua hai brain mein. Theek hai? So in cerebral palsy, what happens? If there is, and in the early trimester, as I told you, if there is a torch infection, if the mother is infected, the child might be a cerebral palsy child. During delivery process, if it's a forced delivery, forceps delivery, or if it is forced delivery, or if the umbilical cord, if it has wound around the neck of the child, and if there is asphyxia, that means less of oxygen to the brain, that can also lead to CP, that is cerebral palsy. This manifestation depends, I mean it varies, okay, depending on the insult of brain. Agar insult kam hai, so there is spasticity kam rahe. You have seen children with fully spastic nature, that is cerebral palsy. Here it's usually a spastic child. It's a spastic child. The symptoms, as I told you, it depends. Some children can speak a bit, can write a bit, can walk with some assistance, with some orthotic supports. But a severe cerebral CP child is wheelchair bound. Yeah? There'll be a lot of contractions. It'll be like this. Yeah? They can't even walk. But some CP child can walk with some assistance. It depends. You are asking something?
Symptoms.
Symptoms, there are no symptoms. Like, these are all the manifestations of it. Then mental.
Ma'am, Down syndrome child, what would be the reason for...
It's a genetic disorder.
Only genetic like are affected during pregnancy?
It can be even hereditary. No, not affected during pregnancy. It's hereditary, usually hereditary.
Okay.
Mental retardation. Mental retardation is due to some changes in the brain. They have still not found out the exact cause of mental retardation. Mental retardation matlab, dimag, mad, what we call in the normal term. So mental retardation, usually CP is associated with some mental retardation. Might be, might not be. Clear? Even autism might be, might not be associated with mental retardation. Down syndrome is usually associated with mental retardation. This again depends on the severity. Some may be mild, some may be moderate, some may be severe. You have lots of variations in this, okay? So think about mental retardation. Obviously they can't fit into the normal schooling, they can't fit with the normal children. They need some special attention, always. Those are also called as special children. Then spina bifida. I think I discussed about this, spina bifida. Spina bifida, here, in the early stages of pregnancy, in the first trimester of pregnancy, if the mother has a folate deficiency, or a folic acid deficiency. Okay? Folic acid or folate is very important for the normal development of the brain and its structures. Yeah? If so they compulsorily they give folate or folic acid supplements. So some people, even without folic acid, the child might be normal. Some cases, what happens? The child is born with a spina bifida. In spina bifida also you have different stages. Stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 and stage 4. Stage 4 is a severe form. Stage 1, usually what happens, there will be no closure of the spinal cord. This usually happens in the end of the spinal cord, where the spinal cord has to fuse. Okay, here at the back, you can see for some people, mild hair-like structure. If you have seen, have you seen? That's mild spina bifida. Spina bifida. Matlab spine has been divided like this. Usually the spinal cord should be fused in the end, to be fused like this. But here in this case, it's slightly divided and it depends on the different stages. So some hair-like structure will be there. So those people will have severe back pain always. That is mild spina bifida. In the severe case, what happens? The spine will not be fused. I mean, the vertebral column, you can see the vertebral content coming out. As soon as the child is born, it is open. I mean, here, the back, it's open. Okay, comes out. Usually, the death rate is the child. Even if it survives in the second or third stage, they'll definitely have this mental retardation. Along with it, the entire body down from here, trunk, will be paralyzed. That is spina bifida. So these children also need, are considered as special children. Clear? Okay. Next is ADHD. That is attention deficit hyperactive disorder. Here, as I told you, there is no problem with the brain and all as such, anything. But here, since they are very hyperactive, you need to do some modifications in your thing. I need to give some special attention to that child until he calms down. So that's why they consider it as a special child. That's it. Dyslexia also, we have discussed this earlier, so I'm not going to discuss it again. Blindness. Blindness also, they are called as special children, even though their other neural structures or neural functions, everything is normal apart from the blindness. Why? Because they need some, because they can't read or write or do anything, they need a brain script. Clear? Okay. Then hearing loss and deafness. Hearing loss and deafness also need special assistance. They use that hearing aid. So if it's a total hearing loss, then you need to totally change the pattern of your teaching using your hand gestures. Yes? So you have the schools for it, right? Yeah? So that means that's also, that's why any middle ear infection, please see to that it's been treated with utmost care so that it not lead to hearing loss and a permanent hearing loss. Yeah, these are all treatable causes. If it is from by birth, you can't do anything. Hearing loss by birth, you can't do anything. Now they have come with cochlear implant. It's very, very expensive surgery. Okay, cochlear implant. They implant the cochlea so that at least some noise it's been heard by the child. And they give an external device also so that it amplifies the noise. Then speech and language impairment. Even speech and language impairment. The speech, if the child is not able to speak properly. So you need to give, you can't teach the child, right? So you need to be first of all trained in that. So you use a lot of gestures, you need a lot of other activities to make the child to understand what he is speaking. So speech and language impairment children also are called as special need children. Then traumatic brain injury because of anything, maybe in a road accident or maybe a fall or maybe during the birth process. Traumatic brain injury children also are considered as special need children. Then severe and or multiple disabilities. Maybe mentally they are normal, but they have other orthopedic disabilities. Okay, one hand is not there or one leg is not there. Okay, or if they have this polio, that flaccid paralysis. Now though it's very, very uncommon, polio. But there are, even now in some places, the polio is still there. Yes? Then cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis, as I told you in the morning class, there is an entire fibrosis of the lungs. So cystic fibrosis, what happens? These children will also have some type of disability. They always need some assistance. So that's why cystic fibrosis people are also considered as special need children. Okay? These are some of them. There are lots and lots, many, which are being considered as special need children. So So the term special needs in the education setting comes into play whenever a child's education is officially altered from what would have been normally provided to students through an individual education plan, and which is sometimes referred to as an individual program plan. That's what I have been telling now. Yeah? Okay, next. What happens? Children with special needs may have mild learning disability or profound mental retardation, starting from allergy to terminal illness. It can be either allergy or terminal illness. They're also called special needs children. So it can be, they can either have a mild learning disability or a profound mental retardation. The range is like that. Okay? So it's very, very confusing. The special needs, especially special needs children, it's very, very confusing. You don't know whom to categorize into the special need and whom as a normal child. Okay? Then food allergies, then developmental delays, they catch up as she told. Then quickly remain entrenched, and occasional panic attacks or serious psychiatric problems. These are all the socio-emotional problems. And special needs are commonly defined by what a child can't do. Socio-emotional problems also sometimes like delinquencies and all. Like they have this habit of stealing, they have the habit of hurting others. They need some special attention, they need some counseling.
What would be the reason for that, ma'am?
Which one?
That social emotional problems. There is no problem in brain or some secretions, nothing like that.
No. Okay? So what the child can't do? Simple term. What the child can't do? By the milestones unmet, foods banned, activities avoided or experiences denied. All these things, whatever you've discussed till now, can be considered as special need children. Okay? So, now we'll discuss some of the characteristics of special need children. So, what are their characteristics? They deviate markedly from a normal child. There's a marked deviation from the normal child. You can easily differentiate a normal and a special need child. Yeah? And deviation may be either physical, intellectual, emotional or social. I've told you this now. Then they need a special environment. You can't have the normal environment what you include the a normal child in. So you always need to have to make some modifications. Yeah? Make some additions or make some deletions for these people. So they need a special environment to learn. Special environment even in the house also. When it comes, if there is a disability, you need to make some alterations, right? So you need to change the, make a special environment. Then special in the school or in a special school, yeah. So these are all some of the characteristics of a special child. Coming to, this is another variation here. Gifted or exceptional children. Gifted children, when I was speaking about IQ, if you remember, I had told about this. Their IQ is very much above the normal. They're all gifted children. So here, that's why they're called as exceptional children, because you can't include them also in the normal class. Because they are not fit for that. Even you are not fit for their intelligence. As a teacher, you'll not be fit for their intelligence. So I think you'll have to sit in the net or browse the net, and you have to be a bookmark then. Only then you can make them understand. Yeah? Okay. In view of many thinkers, psychologists, psychiatrists, etc., exceptional children are the children who remain either extreme side of their achievement scale. Their IQ is very, very, very well beyond the normal. Okay. Here, they have given two statements to describe this exceptional child. One is, exceptional child differ in degree and not in kind. What does that mean? Every child has more or less same kind of potentialities, right? But these potentialities are thought in terms of degree. Exceptional children differ from the average to such a degree in physical or psychological characteristics that school program designed for the majority of children do not afford them opportunity for all-round adjustments and optimum progress, and they therefore need either special instruction or in some cases special ancillary services or both to achieve a level of commensurate with their respective abilities. That means whatever the school is normally providing for that age group, they'll have to make a lot of alterations in that. Okay, these children, they are more at par than the one what they are providing the services. Okay, so that's one thing. And exceptional children differs in quantity and not in quality. So here every exceptional children and average children fall in the same quantitative scale with regard to physical and psychological characteristics. Let it be the physical, the development is the same, the psychological characteristics would be the same. But the proportionately whatever they achieve or whatever they do, that will be at par with the normal child. Let it be in studies, let it be in the other activities, they are at par with those children. So that's why these children are also categorized into a special category children. But they are not into that one, that like mentally retarded or something. Okay, this is totally a different entity. Clear? So here, classification of some exceptional children. Here also again there are different thoughts. Some ways and in some areas they call these children as exceptional children or special children or gifted children. Gifted is totally the IQ is at par. So here in exceptional children you have, they include even the special child also, I mean with mental retardation also. So here you have different categorizations in this. One is intellectually or mentally exceptional children. One variant is gifted children, other is a slow learner and a mentally handicapped. You have beyond, well above the IQ, you have a slow learner who is below the IQ level, and you have a mentally handicapped whose IQ is maybe say 0 to 20. Okay, so these are intellectually or mentally exceptional children. Then emotionally exceptional children, here it comes the delinquences. Here they have those habits of stealing or hurting others, and they have the habit of, I mean they intentionally they might not do it, but because of some problems you have all these antisocial elements, right? So all these children come to that category because they need a special counseling. Yeah. Then physically handicapped children, like visual impairment, orthopedic impairment, hearing impairment, and children with defective speech. We've discussed that just now. All these children are also exceptional children. Then socially handicapped children, due to some social problem, due to some family problems, they are normal, but because of that, they have just taken a backstage. Okay, then neurotic children, all these are the neurotic children, convulsions or the epileptic children. Okay, these children, because if the epilepsy is more, if there is severe epilepsy or severe epileptic seizures, that can lead to mental retardation later. And these severely epileptic children need medications throughout their life. That again depends on the whether it is because of some neuronal damage. If it is because of high fever, usually children have epileptic seizure. If it crosses 105 and all those things, 103, 104, in the early age, they can have the seizure. But that usually comes after 5 years, totally, it just vanishes. It will not be there. But for some children, it's because of the abnormal discharges from the brain itself. Every now and then, they have that. And these children are exceptional children or special children. And if it has not been treated properly, it can lead to MR, mental retardation. Got it? If it is very severe. Then multi-handicapped children, here the disabilities. Maybe he does not have a hand, or he does not have a leg, or both legs are lost. These are all genetic problems. So multi-handicapped children, because they need assistance, they need modifications in their environment, the surrounding environment. Okay, coming to identification. So how do you identify? It's really a very, very difficult task to identify this population. Why difficult task? Mental retardation, you can identify. But whom you need the special needs, whom you categorize under this? Why because once you certify that the child is a special child, government has a lot of policies for them. You know that, right? They get a lot of advantages. So some people misuse it. So that thing should not happen karke. They have clearly defined arenas where you only if these people are satisfying this, they should be called as special children. But the same dyslexic and all those things, they'll not get those advantages from the government. Got it? Only for few categories, the government totally funds their education. They give lot of opportunities, lot of advantages for them. Okay? So that's why it's very, very important. Okay. And not all students match the common definition. Giftedness exists in all cultures. The identification process, both quantitative and assessment of students for inclusion in special classes or receipt of special services, usually takes several steps. It cannot be done in the classroom setup, and you have special people who do this. So please refer it to them. That's it. So common tests, what they do? Few tests we had discussed. That is Wessner's preschool intelligence scale. That's to just check the IQ. In this, again, you have this COGAT test, gifted and talented evaluation scales. We are not going to go in details about this. Just need to know all these tests are available to check the special need children. That is called as Gates test, the Iowa test of basic skills, scales for rating the behavioral characteristics of superior students. Then the Kaufman assessment battery for children, that is called as KABC, or Raven's progressive math. And you have this Wessler's intelligence scale for children. That is the Stanford Binet are the examples for the individually administered IQ test. And coming to the curriculum planning and teaching strategies for these people will be taken by Pooja Madam, because she is expertised in this special education. So I just don't want to go to the teaching part because I'm not that very comfortable with it. So I can just tell you the medical part of it, what it is. So that taken care by madam. Okay, so the curriculum plan here for each and every category, your way of planning, your way of teaching strategies, everything changes. Everything varies. Few examples has been given in your notes, but rest of them will be taken care by madam. Okay, so thank you. So this is it in my psychology. So this, I have completed my psychology portion. In that, we have this vitamins and all those nutritional supplements. Okay, any doubts with this? The special needs children? So I'll wind up with this then. Thank you.